Production underwriting for Ruckus has been made possible in part by the generous contributions from Fred and Lou Hartwig and from viewers like you. Thank you.
Welcome to Ruckus, our weekly food for thought fight over the news of the day and the trends of the times. The movers and shakers are, well, moving and shaking. The General Services Administration announcing plans to move its Bannister employees to downtown Kansas City, Missouri. And a few bi-state, bipartisan legislators are trying to craft a peace treaty to end the economic development war between Missouri and Kansas. But let's start with GSA. What's the likely economic impact of this move for downtown Kansas City, Mary?
It's fabulous. It's wonderful. I mean, 1,000 employees, federal employees, all with wonderful benefits and relatively high salaries compared to other people at this stage of the game. And there's lots of vacant commercial property downtown. It's needed. It's a good idea. It's in keeping with the traditions set by President Carter and every president afterwards of moving when there is a move to go to down the centers of the great American cities, which I think Kansas City is one. And this whole business, however, this is a good thing, bringing these employees downtown. But, you know, the arrangement by which the Bannister facility has become the only private nuclear weapons facility in the country is very complex and deserves a lot of scrutiny from my perspective.
Think it's a good move, Yale, for downtown?
It is a good move, and I'll put my commas in here. The commas being, well, will that many people really move downtown in about 2 years? Talking to a GSA person yesterday, point out, well, actually, they're encouraging more people to work from home these days. You also have to remember that a lot of people work there for a long time. Well, they live out in South Kansas City and, you know, Ray Moore and various areas out there. They're not going to be real happy about having to come downtown. As far as will it absorb some commercial space downtown?
Sure.
Well, that's good. Will they maybe eat lunch out rather than go to whatever cafeteria they're going to have? Well, yeah, that'll be good. My thing on downtown is always, it's great to have more people care about what's happening downtown. Oh, gee, this is another group of people might say, well, no, it'd be good to have a streetcar. Maybe good to have these. So that's all good. The other thing is, South Kansas City has really been devastated by a lot of these things.
Well, that was a point made in a Kansas City Star editorial.
Yeah,
what's good for downtown may not be good for
you. Did you write that?
I live out there,
and so I'm concerned about creating blight in the 6th District, which, you know, you've got the Bannister Mall deal that fell through, and so we've still got that vacant property there, and now we're going to have more big buildings that are vacant, and so what's going to happen there? So, and Yale's right, people aren't moving, they're just going to be working down there, but yet we're creating a problem.
The big new facility is out there, though.
Yeah, but I just think it's
going to employ lots of people. That's the reason the city council has given for subsidizing the transfer of the weapons facility to this new ground, and it's off and running.
The other challenge downtown is the whole parking situation. So the people, how are they going to handle parking? I think it's a great move. Yeah. Don't get me wrong. I think it's a great thing, but there are challenges.
Well, this is Kay Barnes' vision, Mike. You know that we would gradually increase the population. I don't know how many more it is, but people laughed at her when she said 20,000 more people will be living downtown. And I think they're well over that mark.
Now, the other portion of our topic, the economic development war, legislation being discussed that would require both Missouri and Kansas to agree not to use certain tax credits to attract businesses from the other state. You have any sense that that has a hope of survival, Woody?
Well, I noticed that the Jayhawkers are saying the Tigers should go first, but the best thing about that actually is not that I think it's likely to happen, in so much as that Representative Berry, who's one of the Republican on this team, took the initiative some months ago to start trying to form a Kansas City caucus so that Republicans and Democrats in the Kansas City area would start looking after Kansas City, which historically they have not done. They've just squabbled with each other. The St. Louis sends in these suburban stormtroopers all marching in lockstep, and they get whatever they want. Comes time to fix up our stadiums, and guess what? The guys in the district where it's located aren't voting for it. Mm-hmm. So the best news in that whole deal is the Kansas City delegation may actually work together.
Maybe the beginning of something down the road.
Well, I asked Governor Nixon about that on Tuesday when he came to the editorial page, and I expected to get, oh, we're working on it. Got a little bit more than that. I mean, he said that the letter that the 17 area business people wrote last year saying this has kind of got to stop still resonates. And I think you mentioned Republicans. Both states are controlled by Republicans. Both states supposedly hate all this, quote, publicly subsidized investment and when it doesn't really create new jobs. You'd think both states would get together and go, yeah, this really isn't that good when jobs are just being transferred across state line. So I actually hold out some hope that in this next year or so, actually, it's not going to stop necessarily. It's just going to be ratcheted back.
Well,
that's good.
If you can imagine Sam Brownback and Jay Nixon sitting down in the room and coming to an agreement about development, then you could kind of judge whether you think this thing is going to go anyplace. Brownback has been very resistant to any kind of cooperative effort. However, Senator John Vradl and a couple others have shown some real interest in this legislation. I don't know, I've never seen anything like it, but why not try something creative? Because what we're doing now is very damaging to everyone in the metro.
And we kind of know from past experience it's difficult to get both states to pass identical legislation. It finally happened for the bi-state tax, but that took a while.
Yep.
All right, check the latest dictionary for a definition of nirvana, and this is what you might find. The condition of life experienced by residents of a prominent county in northeast Kansas. Okay, I'm exaggerating, but a new survey released by the Overland Park Chamber of Commerce does suggest that a large majority of residents in Johnson County are happy with their way of life, and they think the county is moving in the right direction. Major areas of concern detected by the largely positive survey dealt with the quality of regional political leadership and the level of cooperation among political leaders. Why do you suppose Johnson County and jail perceive weakness in those areas?
Because there are weaknesses in those areas. I did go to the press conference for that and look through a lot of the information that was in the survey. And it's one of those things where geeks like me do find it fascinating. I mean, it's fascinating that, you know, so much of a large portion of Johnson County and thought the nation's off track, but we're doing great. And I think, in general, you could probably say that's true. I mean, economically, they are doing better.
And they weren't excited about the direction of the state.
Right.
Neither
the state nor the nation,
but they love the direction of the county.
But I also pointed out to one of the people who had, promoted the study, that sometimes Johnson Counties think things are going well there when they might not be. I mean, after all, Johnson County had lost the greatest number of jobs of any county in this metropolitan area in, like, 09, except for Jackson County. And yet, I think pretty well thought, oh, no, we're still booming out here. The other takeaway I took from that, which is positive, shut your ears, Woody, is that tax increases are possible out there for the right causes. I mean, they actually asked, would you support tax increases for K-12 education? Absolutely, yes. Well, Blue Valley and Edgerton, Gardner-Edgerton did that. And the other thing is that they also said library, yes. Parks were not as strongly supported, although you never have, you have to have a specific thing in front of you. But I thought it was good that people go, you know, even in recession, we might do something like that.
It is good, but from a perspective of someone who lives there, and it's not out there, it's just three blocks down the street.
No, it's out there. I had to go out there to get
the
press
conference. At all surprising in this, and I don't know why anybody would find it surprising. This is the best place to live. This is Johnson County. It's the best to live if you want to live in a place where everybody has higher incomes than any other county or any other place, and so they enjoy the benefits of that. Now, that's not to say that they don't invest in their county. What it shows is that they're willing to spend money on schools. They are willing to raise taxes, but not bad taxes like sales tax and property
support
tax.
Or the income tax.
If I remember correctly,
if I
made a note here, maybe I'm incorrect. They were pretty evenly divided on whether they favor trading lower income taxes for higher sales taxes.
Yes, right. I read this study. I'm not a geek like Yale, but some citizens read the study. It's easy to look at. Go online. It's right there. It's Chamber of Commerce, Overland Park. They have what you would expect from a moderate centrist, suburban, mostly white county. And it's all very positive because they see where they live as the best part of the state of Kansas, and I can't argue.
Woody, something I saw in this that surprised me a bit, be interested in your reaction. Half of the voters, they surveyed voters and businesses, as you know, half of the voters who were surveyed said illegal immigration is a problem in Johnson County.
Well, first of all, probably many of them have in fact encountered or heard from some neighbor who has encountered illegal immigrant labor. I mean, you have your roof fixed. Who do you think does that? You have landscaping job done. Guess who shows up to do it? And so while Joe Smith may not have had that happen, his friend Steve Brown down the street has seen it and talked about it. So they hear the conversation and they absorb the notion that it's a problem. You and I think of it as no problem in Johnson County. And well, we think of it as no problem in a lot of places. You go down to Cole County, Missouri. They had Hispanic Day before yesterday because there are so many Latinos living down there in Cole County. Same thing in Mount Vernon, Missouri.
Well, what I'm saying
is that even the people in Johnson County may have noticed at last. That's all.
Are you surprised at all about the 50% who say, roughly 50%, that illegal immigrants is a problem in Johnson County?
Absolutely. I mean, what's wrong with having cheap roofs and cheap landscaping, which, of course, is what they're being taken advantage of for? I don't know how that could possibly be based, even given Woody's explanation of, well, you know somebody who knows somebody who knows somebody, that it's a problem.
Right.
Yeah. No, it's not a problem.
It's not a problem.
I mean, the numbers are not there to prove that. It's a problem in Johnson County.
Let's go back to Mary's description of the county as a centrist, bourgeois, middle class.
Yeah, I didn't say
bourgeois. Those kinds of people believe in the enforcement of the law, and when they see it not being enforced,
they think of that as a problem. And on that point, 54%.
You don't, they do.
54% said illegal immigration is an issue best handled by the federal government. Not by the state.
Good for them, because that's true.
Absolutely.
It is a federal law, and local government should have nothing to do with enforcement.
Gwen, you didn't have a chance to say much. You want to make a comment or two there?
No.
I said everything you would have said.
Yale spoke on your behalf
this
time.
Yes, he did. That's fine.
We mentioned Nirvana previously, and here it comes again. It was Nirvana for Kansas City Republicans this past weekend, with the party faithful gathering for events on both sides of the state line. Getting much of the attention was a three-way debate among Republican candidates for the U.S. Senate. One of that trio, John Brunner, Sarah Steelman, or Todd Akin, will likely face incumbent Senator Claire McCaskill, about whom we talked last week. Before we discuss the issues in the campaign, let's talk about the candidates. Woody, give us a thumbnail sketch of each, and if you would, start with Ms. Steelman, Sarah Steelman.
Sarah Steelman's former state treasurer, former state senator. She's run statewide a couple of times, once successfully, once unsuccessfully. The result of that is she has name identification with the kind of, certainly with GOP primary voters, and a reputation as a staunch conservative. Her base will be in southern Missouri, which is a good place to have a base in a Republican primary in this state. A lot of GOP primary voters down there. She's remained steady in the polls pretty much as Brunner has been coming up. And so she's doing okay there. So far, the weakness in her effort is fundraising.
Okay. You mentioned Brunner, John Brunner, and probably most people have at least heard of him now because he's been running an extensive advertising campaign on both radio and television in Kansas City and no doubt elsewhere in the state.
Yes. He's a St. Louis businessman, inherited a small business, grew it into a very big business, and is now running for the Senate, not by any stretch of the imagination entirely self-funded, but self-funded in it to a big degree. And he's spending a lot of that money to get his name ID up, which he started out very low. He's now up to well into double digits. He's from St. Louis. Most of that's come from Todd Akin, his fellow white male suburban St. Louisan. And Akin's gone down in the polls as Brunner has come up. Brunner doesn't have a fundraising problem. And in the polls, he's still third. But he's headed in the right direction.
Tell us a bit about you mentioned Todd Akin, Congressman Todd Akin. What's the story on him? Fairly conservative guy?
Akin's a solid conservative, very conservative guy, suburban St. Louis congressman. And he has strength there where there are a lot of GOP primary voters. But now he may have to split that with Brunner. And his fundraising has been good but not great, and his polling has headed south as Brunner's has headed north.
Let me ask you to analyze this, Mary. If you were advising Republicans running for the U.S. Senate against a friend of yours and somebody you support, Claire McCaskill,
yes, I do.
What would be the areas you'd suggest to the Republicans that they could benefit from in promoting?
Yeah.
Well, first of all, let me just say that sometimes Claire McCaskill and I really don't agree on things, so we're not in 100% agreement here at all. But, well, I think that they ought to look at somebody who's got some experience. I mean, it's not just going to take money. Brunner can really raise. He is the candidate. He is the Mitt Romney of the Republican race for this seat. He's loaded, and he's got the ruling elite of the Republican Party on his side. Todd Akin, does he know where Kansas City is? I mean, has he ever come here and say hello to the people? I don't know. But Sarah Steelman, she's got experience, and these guys are going to have to be a little better prepped. Brunner said that he would do away with the federal gas tax. My gosh, Mike.
He's going to be a very powerful guy.
Senator. If you want to fix up Interstate 70, you got to learn some of the facts there before you
Senators don't do away with the federal gas tax by themselves.
It's a federal
what I would say to them is
but one senator can't do it.
They need to get a really highly competent political coach to go up against Claire McCaskill. So far, they haven't demonstrated that they have the debate skills and the depth of knowledge on the issues to debate Claire and win on the issue. I mean, Claire is an excellent campaigner, and she's a great debater. And so these three people have not demonstrated that they can out-campaign Claire McCaskill.
What do you think the issues would be? How would the Republicans frame the case against Claire McCaskill?
Oh, well, she's an Obama clone. I mean, she's responsible for high unemployment. She's responsible for high gasoline prices. She's responsible for the $15 trillion deficit. I mean, I think that's a case they will be trying to make. You know, you need somebody in Missouri who will go in there with Roy Blunt and be conservative. Be conservative on spending, be conservative on tax cuts, all that kind of stuff. Now, will that sell? And I guess I'll pick up on something Mary said. You know, we're sitting here in Kansas City. Mm-hmm. Claire McCaskill used to live in Kansas City and at least knows where we are. I don't really think any of the people, including, Sarah Steelman, who has run statewide, has a great affinity for the entire Kansas City area. Yeah. That doesn't mean, you still have to look at it, Republican, Democrat, I understand that. But boy, I'd be kind of wondering about what they can actually do for the Kansas City area, if anything, better than Claire McCaskill.
Yeah, I would just note that Claire McCaskill was once the Jackson County prosecuting attorney.
Yes, I didn't want to go into
the state legislature.
I could have done that.
I know you could have. I just wanted to clarify that she's not completely a stranger by any stretch of the imagination.
Never been defeated.
Don't be a stranger, Claire.
Reporter Joe Robertson describes parents in the now unaccredited Kansas City School District as surviving a storm, but having difficulty seeing through the fog of uncertainty that resulted from what happened. The options for change seem to increase, and so does the opposition to each of the options. Should there be a state takeover? What about breaking up the district into smaller sections? What's State Senator Victor Callahan's role in all of this? What's his goal? It seems the only thing that is clear about the district is the lack of clarity. So, Gwen, can you clarify things for us?
Well,
you have 45 seconds.
45 seconds.
We need more time than that.
Well, you've got several issues here for parents to try to sort through. Number one is the issue of annexation or carving up the district into different pieces and having it managed by surrounding districts like North Kansas City, Raytown, Center, and Independence. And that's supported by Missouri State Senator Victor Callahan, and who thinks that making such a decision should be done by a vote, a referendum, and we should have an election and let the people decide. Then you have Republican Representative Jane Cunningham, who is putting forth legislation to parcel out the district without a vote, just do it by legislative fiat. So. Then that's the issue. The other issue is about transfers, which it deals with the Turner-Clayton case, and do we allow with which is mandated by law for de-accredited districts. What parents don't know now is, can they move their kids? Who pays? If there is a tuition, what should that be? So there are lots of ambiguities around that that have not been resolved because we have two cases pending, one in Jackson County, one in St. Louis. Both of those cases seem to be getting moved, moving slow. lots of continuances. So then the other option here recently, this past week, two bills made it out of committee. There's the Lair bill and there's the Pierce bill. These bills would actually empower DESE, the Department of Elementary and Secondary Education, to intervene prior to the termination of the two-year clock on the de-accredited district, and to appoint us a state-appointed board and to begin to address the issues now. Those two bills probably are the stronger options because the Cunningham bill is dead, is like dying on the vine. Governor Nixon is our, if it gets anywhere, we're pretty certain he will veto it because he is not supportive of chopping up the district. But the biggest issue here is what could happen is absolutely nothing, which is really a shame that Nicastro came in.
That's state education commissioner.
Yeah, de-accredited the district without having a plan in place as to how to address all of these ambiguities and complexities. They should have worked that out in advance of this.
Gwen's done a superb job of laying out all the options.
I'm still awake.
But but still, nothing has happened, and who knows what is going to happen. It still seems to be a shroud of uncertainty.
I hope Jay Nixon remembers this in about 10 minutes when I give him my roast, but I'll toast him for saying that this process has been pretty good because a lot of ideas have come forward. I agree with Gwen. One thing I think will happen is a state-appointed board to run the Kansas City District. I just think that's going to happen. That's one thing. Two, I think the transfer, a transfer bill might be passed, and I think it would be, and I agree, I would hope it would be Callahan's, which allow people to vote. But frankly, I don't see a lot of interest in taking over. I mean, Center might have some of the Southwest. I don't think Raytown or North Kansas City.
Why would the other school districts want
exactly.
to import students?
They might want to. They might want to get little bits and pieces. You know, Center get the Southwest part.
But it's not the best thing for the kids. It's not the best thing for the children. If you know, the busing and moving around again. It's
but Gwen, what they're trying to do is make the again a point that Jay made that I've been saying for years. Kansas City District is now down to a more manageable size, 17,000 kids. Let's say 2,000 or 3,000, 4,000 go over to Center or Independence or whatever. You're still going to have some low-performing districts that an appointed board could oversee.
Woody, you spend time in Jeff City talking to legislators. What kind of a sense do you get about what might be likely to occur with the Kansas City District?
Well, the most likely thing to occur is just what Gwen said, which at the end of the day is nothing.
Nothing.
Because you've got so many moving parts here, so many bills flying around, and the tendency is to, when somebody else's bill comes through, is load your stuff onto it. And so then they get bigger and bigger and bigger, and then they die of their own weight. And that's the most likely thing. Gwen didn't mention a bill that came out of committee at 8:30 yesterday morning, which is a reform bill that also fixes the foundation formula and has a tuition tax credits in it, charter school reform, all kinds of things.
Okay.
That passed out of the House Education Committee. There have got to be 10 vehicles on this subject.
A lot of uncertainty, and we don't have time to pursue it any further. I'm sorry. Now it's time for Roast and Toast, where the Ruckettes give a kick in the seat or a pat on the back to people and events in the news. And we start tonight with Yale.
Well, hi, Governor Jay Nixon. You could say that you are spineless when it comes to cigarette tax, or lame. That would be name-calling. How about just destructive, plain destructive, by not allowing a vote on having a higher sales tax, or excuse me, a higher cigarette tax, which, by the way, the state has the lowest in the nation. You're not allowing universities to get more money. You're not allowing health care agencies to get more money. And therefore, you're sentencing people who smoke to having higher out-of-pocket costs to pay for the health problems they're having. It's a very costly problem for Missouri. Missouri's at the bottom. Show some leadership on this, Governor, please.
Hi, Governor Brownback. How are you? I really have to just, the worst of the tax plan, in today's Kansas City Star, Harriet Duff, I'm going to toast her, the president of Johnson County League of Women Voters, for really letting the governor have it in very clear terms. His tax plan takes after working families like few public officials have in our recent memory. He wants to repeal the earned income tax credit, which is a bipartisan, has always enjoyed bipartisan support, the best tool for lifting working families out of poverty and keeping them there, people who work every day for a living, and he wants to repeal it. 80% of the people in Kansas will get a tax increase under his plan. 20% will get wonderful big tax cuts. Unjust.
To the point. Hello, Rick Santorum. Shame on you for interjecting atavistic social mores into the 21st century political campaign and still questioning the authenticity of the President of the United States.
A toast to Representative Scott Dekaus, the chairman of the House Education Committee in the Missouri General Assembly, who herded a vote through at long last on that education reform bill I talked about a few minutes ago. It's long overdue. You know, patience is a virtue, Representative Dekaus, but you showed way too much of it last year. It was nice to see you finally exhaust it this year and force a vote. Good work.
And remember when the Kansas City Star used to run pictures with the headline, "Separated at Birth"? Well, here's our version. It occurred to me while I was watching KCPT last Friday as Governor Sam Brownback was on Week in Review, and Michael Feinstein's program, The American Songbook, aired 1 hour later. Judge for yourself. Can't help but wonder, is Feinstein a Republican? Can Brownback sing? That's Ruckus for this week. Nick Haynes will host Kansas City Week in Review Friday evening at 7:30. Now, on behalf of the Ruckettes and producer Sean Holmes, I'm Mike Shannon. Thanks very much for watching, and good night.
Production underwriting for Ruckus has been made possible in part by the generous contributions from Fred and Lou Hartwig and from viewers like you. Thank you.